USM, and then also art history at UCLA, and art authentication and conservation at Melbourne University.
Yeah.
And he was also a curator at the Negara Museums, and also a director at the Petronas Gallery. So, Sehan is an art curator and also art writer, was formerly attached to National Art Gallery and Art Gallery Petronas. And he's also involved in the music scene as a singer, songwriter.
Yeah,
and I realized. So I think it's quite interesting and has organized different gigs. Yeah, we would love to hear about that as well. And you have a special interest in abstract art and works by self-taught artists and outsider artists. And then also we have Beverly and Rachel with us today, who are co-founders and also directors at Rogue Art. And Beverly is a writer, curator, and also an editor and gallerist who specializes in Southeast Asian art. And Rachel, you teach professional art practice in the Dasein College of Art.
Part-time.
And you also specialize in art management.
Yeah, I'm a graduate from UniMass.
UniMass, yeah. And I also realized that you also
yes.
from
she's
UniMass.
Nice. She's nice.
And you taught at UniMass as well. Alright, so I'll pass the time to Emily, who will speak a little bit about the book.
Well, first of all, thanks so much to Emelia and to the faculty at UM for having helping to organizing this talk. So I guess you all know the project, Narratives in Malaysian Art. Just a little bit of backstory that this project I think started in 2008-2009. So it's 10 years now, and we've got through the four volumes, and we finally published the last volume in September. So I think a lot of you have read the first two volumes, The National Identities and Reactions, New Political Strategies. I think that's what we're going to focus on today, right? But just to let you know, we have copies of volumes 1, 2, 3, and 4, Infrastructures, book from 2016, and the latest book, Perspectives. Perspectives is quite interesting because it has both three sections. There's a section on art in the public, so perceptions of art and how it interacts with society in Malaysia. And then it has a section on curating, how curators have kind of what their agendas and motives have been in shaping how we see Malaysian art through exhibition. And finally, the biggest section is actually on art history itself, the writing of art history. So there are little reflections on main primary texts like Piyadasa and Zabas, Modern Artists of Malaysia. Zabas has also a little reflection on vision and idea and how that was written. IGTN, who translated Marco Su's Brief History of Malayan Art, he's also written about his experience. So there's a text looking back, and also some newer essays, commissioned essays, looking at what hasn't been covered, the ways we haven't written about Malaysian art, by Ray Lamamba, Rupesh Tharam, Mon Lau. So it's the whole the back section is all on art history. So I hope you will all have a copy of the book later today. Now we've finished the volumes. We're doing this sort of roadshow, hoping to engage students like yourself or art historians like yourself to talk about where sort of art history narratives are going from now, or what's missing, and building conversations around it. So this is a really important part of the project. So thank you very much for participating.
And then just to introduce you guys to the students, I think about 7 are from the current Malaysian art class. And the rest are actually those who have already taken the class, but they're still in the program. They're writing their thesis, Case, one of them, Ankim, and Aina, and all of them. And then we have two alumni, who is QA and Melvin, who have finished their course, but they're also still interested to come, so thank you for coming. And, and then we have foreign students as well from Philippines. Like this, and then we have Feng from China. Yeah. So, maybe we can start off
four decades. So what happens now? I remember that I've been telling the chancellor so many times. Some of you were involved here, I think. There was somewhere, I can't remember which wall, there was a mural by Muslim.
There
was a little bit of scandal, some white washing. Sports complex somewhere.
Yes, yes, it's over there, yeah, just nearby.
Some mural is there?
Yes, the mural is there now. It's protected now.
Let me just say something personal, historical. In 1972, rather, when I was a first student at USM, and then first as a social science student, and then later when Zabas just became a lecturer there, and was planning to start the fine arts department, told us in the introduction to art class that it's going to be an art major. I was excited because I couldn't study art outside the country. I didn't have any money. All my friends had their own under private scholarship or government scholarship. I was there at USM and intending to study among the choices of courses offered at the university. Anthropology and social science or something like that. So I said, yeah, I met a major in there. And then after I heard about the art history, or art, fine arts, sorry, fine arts department, and major, I shifted to the humanities. One of the assignments given by Sarabati to students studying the fine arts over the term break was to interview an artist. That was to compile the writing. I don't know where the writing is on, but it was all of us. It's an Arashim, several people, names of all and 23 of us majoring in fine arts in the first batch. We did. My choice of artist was in fifth college at the time, Ibrahim Hussein. So I went to interview him during the break, during holiday. I went to his room, fifth college. There he was in the room, in his apartment. Super movie was in show on a small screen, and music, hi-fi was on, and the camera was on, for what reason. Everything was on, I didn't know what he was listening to. So it was the background of our interview, but it was quite interesting. And that little piece was about his life, maybe after, it's funny, it crossed my mind to write down something. It was about his life, highlighting the fact that he was in New York during a major team incident. I saw everything on TV in color, which we in Malaysia didn't know, didn't see. So that was a good that he told me. And that was my assignment. So this is just to indicate what kind of beginning this teaching of art, especially the theoretical part, or the assignment part, is non-practical. But before majoring, at the end of first year, in order to be considered for as a major, we all had to submit an artwork. Which is strange, because I guess they wanted to know whether you had any indication of visual intelligence or something, artistic intelligence. One particular work of mine, I had several. It's not in the National Gallery. Detroit.
Let's look for it.
Yeah. very impressed by what people John Lennon. And the title of the work is something I wrote down, and there was, I woke up this morning, I felt something heavy on my head, and discovered that it was my head. That was John Lennon quote. The reach, or the title of the work was the reach, was the plaka, plaka color. So, maybe that's an indication of how I went into art history through art practice, like most of us. Which surprised me because I did not think that Kanaga was an artist, but he was teaching art history. I thought, oh, well, it's art history. I mean, still of school, you know. By not practicing hard. Later on, I asked Kanaga when I was up and on stage at this place here. I mean, Penang. And he said, no. I'm just a non-practicing artist. That's true. He's a non-practicing artist. I've never seen his artwork. The others were artists. Ligui, Chutin Bay, Robert Croc was a photographer, Peter Glanser. Top sculpture, Hungarian, Australian, who was more interested in building his boat to sail back to Europe. The boat go down at the edge of the campus in USM, reserved for him, within which he built his boat. And actually, later on, he also brought in about how many tons of marble into the building. And made a sculpture that's now in USM, at the top of the hill, called Transformation. You can see that in USM. So it was essentially a department of fine arts meant for practitioners. I kind of liked it because it was different from UITM, School of Art. But over there, the emphasis was on practical arts. You do your art, you choose a major. In USM, the major was, I think you take fine arts, you choose a few subjects, and there's some obligatory subjects in theory, which included aesthetics, art history methodology, modern religion art, aspects of Asian art, art choices. The historical part were handled by Sabhapati alone. Sometimes he would call his philosopher into the aesthetics class, the Dutch guy, Dr. Cornelius Simons. In that time, a whole chunk of USM staff were non-Malaysians. Which made them immensely wonderful, I think. And he was like that too at the time. This happened because the Vice Chancellor then, Professor, the first Vice Chancellor, was the person who decided that USM, notwithstanding the fact that it is a university of science, should have a humanities sector in the education. Students. So that's also because he decided that being a planner and an urban planner, also, I'm not sure whether he was an architect, he wanted to later establish the architecture school, part of it was architecture. So he said that the School of Humanities should include fine arts, theatre, music came later. And that was how USM is just a small department in the School of Humanities. And history of art wasn't a major. But what was the major was the fine arts major, which was divided between theoretical and practical arts. Now let's maybe jump forward a bit to the 60s. Here to be on the think about history in Malaysia. Mission and idea, relooking Malaysian art was a project, probably the first so-called substantial, or intentionally, by intention to be substantial, first book publication. Otherwise, before that, all theoretical and historical books were about, were related to catalogs, newspaper reporting, and promotion of artists. This is incidental. This actually wasn't so strange because the import of art, of Western art from England and such at that time had a big sector of concomitant community of expatriates who found that art was something to reflect on their status of having some kind of taste. And that's why the early artists had patrons in the form of investors, people who were expatriates. They became part of the community of foreign colonies that came here with the British Council, the US United States Information Service, the Goethe Institute, the National German Society, and the Allianz Society. And several others. Later on, possibly, you know what you call it, the Grand Council or something. Cultural Council. So those things should be considered when you start about, you start talking about the beginnings of colonialism in terms of culture in Malaysia. What I meant about the whole world, you know, especially South Asia, Philippines, Indonesia. I once, my first trip to Vietnam in Jakarta, last year before Sumatra was brought down, I mean, we were running. I brought a Malaysian art there, and she was so Malaysian artist. I was surprised. We were staying in the hotel in Indonesia. You know about Indonesia that much, and the hotel in Indonesia, the world has to be real. But this is not Indonesia, this is not Jakarta, this is in Moscow. All these new rules, you know. Well, China maybe, you know, that time, you know. So, the thing I want to say is that in talking about the beginning of art history in Malaysia, and Asia probably the rest of the colonized world, you have to go through the history of colonialism. You have to. And that wasn't said in a very deep way before, which is an idea. But didn't go that deep anyway. You know? But there were talks about our education, it's brought in through, art education is brought in through education in schools and things like that. You know? But it wasn't so deep. So I'm having a following art history. You guys are researching on art history and studying art history. Now, I have not seen an in-depth investigation of art education in school in Malaysia. Maybe, I think in Philippines, I says, in several books, in fact, several investigations. So that's one thing to look at. Because, like I said, the art thing, culture, okay, true colonialism, culture is modern culture, modern art. Well, there are many things to say how to begin, but just now I touched upon the fact that there is an official art history and there is a what I call anecdotal episodal art history. So when I talk about something, most of my special talks in groups, I will jump here and there, and my talk will be in the form of vignettes. cartoon. My mind worked that way. There's no book inside there. There are only small pictures or posters. Small columns. So among that, another column that says another V-neck is about those people who were not in the mainstream Malaysian art history. Why did this happen? Like anywhere in the world, there are cliques, there are power struggles, and there are cultural struggles within the context of colonialism, and within that context, you have internal strife, cultural strife, like a better term, among all the communities, so which comes down to, boil down to political scenario. So those things have to be definitely there. You can't talk about art without talking about politics. You really can't. Because as long as you stick to official art, as long as you have the legendary Piyadasa, it has the politics. I'm not sure whether it's just a side line. Piyadasa know what was going to be there. Maybe there's one in heaven.
Yeah, when he left, it was this place was all classes and offices.
Because Piyadasa, well, in some way, sideman of got caught in that struggle, social, cultural struggle, because he has his own mind. There's several people. One person who would have been in vision idea was Wong Wai Chong. He opted out, didn't even go to the meeting. So, for whatever reason, but I guess she has his reason. But it would have been a different book if Wai Chong was there. These are the things that I thought so much today. But certainly, in writing about Malaysian art, little things like that are actually big things. And these are the things that were not envisioned an idea. Which came to my mind much later. And this was because I did an art history major master's thesis in overseas in UCLA, which was applied to us for liberalism's sake, I would say. Social art history, not sociology of art, but essentially most of it was Marxist art history. It was the beginning of the overhaul of the teaching of art history in the US after the Second World War, trickling down of refugees, academic refugees from Europe, from Germany especially, who went to London. Stop over in London, but we only moved to America, US, United States. The Warburg Institute in England, in London, where I think Bromwich was in Stonebridge, art historian, became a research institute on this, mainly in artistry. And then we had Bromwich was a wonderful, I heard him talking. Give a talk at Pasadena County Art Museum once. He couldn't understand my Dutch accent, the German accent was too strong. Anyway, I love his writings. He left Germany because he was anti-Nazi fascism. So, in London, he was in Auburn with several other people. Maybe Auburn, actually. And he was not just anti-Nazi, he was anti-communist in general. So his books were academic, pure, traditional, classical writings. On the other side, we have several people. We have the most sensational socialist, communist art historian among the English, Mr. Sir Anthony Blunt. who was a Soviet spy, sir, and he was with the Control Institute, teaching them. No, it was, sorry. Warburg did not teach in Warburg Institute. Control Institute was mainly, I don't know, one of them was a research center, one was a teaching institute. Anyway, later we had both things. Outside of that, we had other people like the club. So this kind of thing became sensational. Right? And in 1972, John Berger, who was a socialist writer, came up with a book and a BBC program called Ways of Seeing. And that is an influential book to study art and art history for students who went to university at that time, in England especially, and later in America. I talked a bit about even that, because I didn't study art history. I didn't study at all in England. I said that I did my sabbatical research at School of Oriental African Studies. Not much later, it was 1994, 95. You were there already. Yeah. Close to a year. There you go. The reason I talk about England, because in books that I later read about art history, they were published. I had certain orientations to study of art history in England. Art theory. And my supervisor in UCLA was a student of PhD student under Gombrich. Let me use it under David Kanzel. He wrote all about comics. The history of early comic strip is big. It's one of the seminal history, early books of art history, about comics. Now a lot of people follow his footprints in his training in writing about comics, because now we realize that comics is another essential aspect of writing art history. I'm going to tell you all about my first dissertation. New video and everything. So, a new kind of visuality in media, in form of art history. In my days, only that book that I read, and it became my supervisor, which influenced me first to do research on the treatment of foreign labor, especially Chinese labor in Los Angeles, as depicted in comics and illustrated magazines. But somehow somebody changed my mind, because I didn't have time much. They said, that belongs to a PhD dissertation. I said, one can start a master's. Okay, sometimes you can't find a supervisor. But David Council had like a, I don't know, 20 students under him. So I think it's something else. But whole lot of people who thought I should do that were either inclined to sociology of art, socialist history of art, or they are the traditional ones. There's a whole group of traditional ones. Very, very good people, scholars, I mean, and some in economy and art, and some in Chinese art. In Chinese art, Professor Martin Powers. He was one of my supervisors. I had four supervisors. In the end, there was a guy called Alan Wallach. Social history of patronage.
Emphasize a lot of social history.
could feel there was sort of a struggle, I think, with kind of the new art history and sort of the postmodern approaches of looking at art history. And it was sort of I could sense there was him wanting to sort of not wanting to move there. Trying to find, I think using sort of the post-colonial as a sort of framework, as what you mentioned just now. Even right now, I feel that it's quite a challenge to teach art history and to write the curriculum. I find the books, the series are very helpful in the sense that it provides a sort of like a chronology, and I think I try to start with that chronology. And then, because the chronology always presents art history in a sort of very neat narrative, then maybe after that to try to use different themes, and as you mentioned, to try and like maybe interrupt this sort of neat narrative, like for instance, like cultural identity, politics, and nationalism, tradition and modernity, and this sort of contradiction, and then use those themes to try and to talk about this chronology. I was also wondering, like from Sehan's point of view, like how do you sort of develop your art writing, because you didn't actually study art history, right? So like from that kind of perspective, like which writers or what kind of art history did you were you interested in?
Okay. Okay, basically I was trained as a visual artist. I didn't practice because it was a bit too difficult, because the area that I'm interested in is more into psychological mandalas based on Carl Jung's, some ideas by Carl Jung and all that. And when you do works which are too personal, once you are out of that zone, when you try to produce it, it's actually quite tedious. So you have to be in a certain situation to be able to produce. And when I came back from Sarawak, when I was studying in Dimash, I was more interested in music because music is more immediate. We were involved with the so-called singer-songwriter scene at the time, which were basically producing original music by locals, singing about local realities. But it was a very interesting time because we had a lot of people who came back from abroad who were exposed to that idea at the time, and they were interested in performing local music. Just for the record, we managed to host Yuna in one of our big events called KL Sing Song before she exploded, before she went to LA or whatever. So I'm quite proud of it, but I don't think she's going to acknowledge it now. But anyway, after doing all these things, you realize that you got a degree, you're not a practicing artist, and you still have to make a living. So one of the things that I realized that there was not enough writing, or rather people were not interested in writing about artists or celebrating artists, or even talking about, allowing the artist to actually say what they want to say. So I thought, okay, maybe I can try to make some money in this area. I know some artist friends and I interviewed them and so forth. But again, when you talk about art history, I was not interested in art history because probably the way it was taught was a bit was neither here nor there. I bought the Vision and Idea book when it came out. I bought it 2 times, lost 2 copies, but the copy is still with me. And when I first read it, it was very difficult because I thought, I don't know what the hell you're talking about, because we're so used to things developed in very linear kind of a fashion. B comes after A, C comes after B, and this book was quite difficult to read and understand. I only I came to value it much later when I was forced to teach art history part time. I teach on the diploma level, MIA, and also design project. And I realized I have to be able to explain the development of Malaysian art in more consistent and also interesting ways. We were not taught about political influences, social forces, the imposition, the meta narratives, by the powers that be, especially in regards to how art development has. That book itself was very eye-opening because I also realized that I could use a lot of information, ask questions, and also come to different conclusions, and also use the information since it was printed. Right? I can use it to justify my curatorial work. I could use it to justify ideas that I basically believed in. Biased towards abstract art, especially abstract art, Malaysian abstract art, also international abstract art. And I could use those information to basically justify why in Malaysia we have abstract art. So it was very, very useful. Publication is very useful. And it also helped when I was working for the National Gallery. I was there for 5 years. And we actually had plans, we had plans to actually translate before I left. I actually told the publications person that, hey, send in this proposal to the boss, let's ask for budget for next year to republish visions and ideas in the national language and at a very affordable format, because I felt that was lacking in a lot of our artists. As artists, we really don't care. We just want to produce, especially nowadays, it's so easy to, we're exposed to images constantly, so easy access to images. You could just get any image that you want, copy, modify, and come up with a piece of work. But where is the context and what is the reason for it? So I realized, wow, this is going back to these books and a lot of other publications, especially published by the National Academy, who was very useful to put things in context. The contributions by our seniors, actually, that is also another reason why I use the information from all these steps, because it's also to acknowledge their contribution, the issues that they brought up. I mean, besides visions and ideas, we also have mystical reality, towards mystical reality. That was a very good publication. Even though I may not agree with all that was written, in classes we do ask questions, we do criticize, we do make fun of certain things. I mean, mystical reality was basically an expression of rubbish. But the ideas behind it was, wow, that was very interesting.
Literally, yeah?
Yes. It was rubbish. After the show, some of the objects were thrown. The National Art Gallery only managed to buy two objects because these two objects is proper art objects, like the birdcage and also the empty canvas, So, wow, that was very interesting. And as Zabas has mentioned, there's also a need to look beyond the meta narrative, to look at some of the other artists who have been sidelined, which I'm doing. Thankfully, I have the opportunity to actually highlight artists who they may not be important, but they played a part in the early stages of the local art. I'm actively doing it now through my curatorial work and all that to highlight what they have done. So I think that is how I view
these artists.
These artists, I've been given the opportunity, very luckily, because I can actually do more or less what I like. So when I curate exhibitions, I can basically look at the artists that I like. I grew up in the 80s, I'm Gen X, so we have a lot of different exposures to different things and a lot of this are not they are not highlighted, not because there's just not enough writers. There's just not enough writers, art historians. We have the seniors, they've done their part, you know, but on a broader scale, we just do not have enough. So, and these are some of the artists who have contributed, really they have passed around. Mm-hmm. They have contributed to the Batik scene. I should have also included in my book that I grew Batik, but not Malaysian Batik. Why? Because we started drawing on Batik. Batik has been around for a long time. Indonesia, of course, is the undisputed master. Any Indonesians here? On record, it's the undisputed master, but we started drawing on Batik and that turned craft into art. So those are the kind of contributions that we have to highlight. Things that we have tried to do in response or as a result of social forces, you know, as we're moving towards Merdeka and so forth. But the other thing that that also has come about is art today has been too much about politics, talking about identity and so forth. I don't remember any of the art history classes I've been. But your time you were so lucky because you had studies in aesthetics and philosophy of art. You didn't have that actually. So it was more like, oh, this is what happened. So art today has moved more towards social commentary and so forth. And I find it very boring. And you know, we don't talk about aesthetics, we don't talk about beauty, we don't talk about things which are subtle things, but it gives life more meaning instead of just focus on conflicts and power struggles of the left or the right or whatnot. So if you notice when you look at artwork, you know, as people who have actually studied art history, you will use words such as, oh, that's interesting, but you won't use words such as, oh, that's beautiful. So I think that is also one of the results of looking at art history. You kind of realize that we don't celebrate beauty, we just talk about ideas. So anyway, that's where I'm from.
Okay. Maybe we take some time to let the students give some comments on how they find the festivals, especially on narratives in Malaysian art. I think one of the students mentioned that you need some kind of background first before reading the books, and then there's like this huge gap. If a student comes in and they didn't have any background in art, at least a background in sort of world art history, then they would find it very difficult to read the books. Is that you shared that, right?
I think from my perspective and my experience that I actually still going on, where the appreciation of art, when you don't know where the history, the source coming from, so the appreciation towards it is very minimal. So of course they don't, youngsters or whoever wants to explore art, when they don't have the base, they don't have the platform, the foundation, the proper beginning of it. So for sure they will start feeling like it's just going to be a huge stepping stone rather than small steps in understanding the existence of art. Like recently, I experienced that my younger brother was actually asking that what was Perak Man all about, and we know that we have cave paintings in Malaysia, but it was not exposed much. Is it because the publication is not out, or is it because of there is no enough sources to support that? And then we also know that there is a few existence in Bunia. So for me, I feel like we have to be start from the school. So
that's teaching. College.
Yeah, I'm teaching at SEDI.
You also teach visual culture, right?
Yeah, I'm teaching art history for a diploma.
So
I'm struggling. I'm really struggling because whenever I start with, okay, let's talk about the early Paleolithic era, students, they already start with like, so do we really need to learn art history? Like,
do you touch anything on Malaysian art history?
Yeah, actually they are surprised. I bring the books every day to college so that they can actually look at it. And they are very surprised that they said they didn't know all this. And I said, yeah, you have to start going out. I mean, and know all this, you know? Like,
do you bring them to the National Museum?
If I get approval from the
try to do it outside, because you know, I teach art history as well, and I usually have a disclaimer. On the first day of class, I'll ask them things Malaysian art history. So I'll ask them what is the first thing that comes to mind, which is Malaysian. So they'll talk about food and all that, blah blah blah. But then I'll tell them that other countries have all this as well. So what exactly is Malaysian? Second, I'll talk about art. What exactly is art? The difference between art and craft. So if you, of course, then we have history. So history of Malaysia is maybe about 100 years old, but we have a rich history, heritage, which is at least a few thousand years old. And we'll start with Paleolithic and all this stuff. But it's easier, you know, we don't have to cover too much, but it's easier if you bring them to the National Museum. Then they can see for themselves the so-called development. Of course, you have to also include like social or psychological or whatever, you know, why people do all these things, because people understand that they know the reason. And it's only a small part, but I understand what you mean. But it's covered in the visions and my ideas, I think. I think that was a very good.
Do you guys use the encyclopedia at all?
I have the encyclopedia, that's also a very good one.
We have to think about that. It hasn't been investigated in that way yet.
Huh? There are other commercial aspects. You have to study economic history. Then you have to study about tourism, about cultural struggle between ethnicities and culture. All those things. That will make it more wholesome, more holistic. So the study of art is not just about, hey, why you choose that color, why this color, right? Even that, you can say, why did you choose that color? It's probably got to do something about where you come from, you know? So those things, that's why you have certain fields of aesthetics, fields like semiotics. These are things that need to be investigated. So the study of art is, artistry is about us trying to understand our culture, our life. It's not just study of art. It's people say art is that one. You find in the London Museum, you find in the Metropolitan Art Museum, that's art. How's our friend here, the outside expert?
That is exactly how I teach the students. Art is a product of its time. So each period reflects the development of the social, cultural, political situation, and also of the things, you know, the things that you see, they are also things that you do not see, which are being sidelined. So it's quite interesting. I don't know about teaching art today. It's quite difficult because we live in a very mix and match time, you know? So anything can be art. So
that's maybe one of the things. There are also those of you who don't come from an art background, and then you've chosen to take your master's in art. And I was just wondering if you can comment a little bit on what is your reaction when you read your first reading of these books. Was it very thoughtful, or was it difficult to digest, or at the level without that?
Change to something I like drawing and painting, and that's it. And I didn't know that UM visual art has nothing to do with practical things. I didn't research enough, and I just applied and I got it, and I graduated. So there's nothing to be proud of. I don't feel proud. At times, I regretted that I changed. Actually, at times I don't. So when I first came and I found out that it was all about street and theory, I was wondering what am I doing here? What is my path later on? But then for me, I'm the type of person, when I decided I made a decision, I will finish it. So, and my research was on Chinese painting. So for Malaysia narrative, that book, I think it's only Dr. Emelia's article is rather applicable, just a little bit on Chinese painting. When I first read the book, I just browsed through. I don't read the whole book. I read your article a few times. I digest just a little bit, and that's it. I don't touch the book anymore. Then, what else? Why I chose Chinese painting in my research? I also don't know, it just, probably I was learning Chinese painting myself at that time, so I chose and pick and others. And then in my research,
I think not
so much passionate or not passionate, it's just it's
related to you.
Not so much related, but you have to finish your research anyway, you have to pick a topic. You have to pick. If you say I love Chinese painting, not so much, but I don't hate Chinese painting. Then
so you mean after studying art history, you didn't do anything to sort of move you towards a deeper study of your own things and how each direction?
No, not so much. Not really.
Yeah. It's got the opposite effect.
Sometimes, at times. So, and then my research, I've only quoted Marco Su's books, and one is Tan Chi Ken. He produced one book in Malaysia art history, rather general, but I quoted some of the things that he wrote.
Tan Chin Huan.
Because there's one new book which is written in Chinese, that's Tan Chin Huan.
Oh, yeah, Tan Chin Huan.
Oh, wow, yeah.
I think
it's in Chinese version.
I think that is Tan Chin Huan.
Tan Chin Huan. Ah, okay.
Doctor Tan Chin Huan is.
From
Seremban.
Yeah.
Psychiatrist. I don't think he wrote a book. Yu Kok-chun wrote it, but he renamed it in Package, the Comprehensive History of Malaysian Art. That was written by Yu. I think you're talking about Tan Chin Huan.
Not Yu Kok-chun. Tan Chin Huan. And that's it. Vision and idea, you know, there's something about.
Yeah, that's. I just want to say that was a struggle we had when looking at topics we wanted to cover. And we wanted to cover Chinese painting, but we couldn't actually find a writer who was willing to. Perhaps we didn't have the right connections, or we couldn't find someone to write that piece on Chinese ink. So that was a regret.
You mean an art historical piece or
a
precision piece?
Some sort of overview of the development we couldn't find, so that's something we had to sacrifice. Yeah, so that's it.
Yes.
Perhaps it could have been different from you if you had a bit more information.
But there's definitely a very big piece of the Chinese painting, that area. Yeah.
But it's developed very separately from the whole modern art story as such, right? Yeah.
Because one thing that's quite strange is that they're not enough art writers, especially those from Chinese speaking, you know. And a lot of information, especially those from Chinese artists, you know, that a lot of painting artists are Chinese. Information is available, catalogs were published in Chinese, you know, and we don't see a lot of Chinese writers writing about it, researching on it, you know. There's still a lot of great area, and even when Piyadasa and Sabapati did the Malayan artists, the NAFA artists themselves criticized them because they said that, oh, these guys don't do Chinese, there's no such thing as Malayan style or not. But yeah, but you are not doing your part to clarify, you know, the great area. So this is what we have left, you know, and this is what we go with. About that thing, about your working, before I came here, I was told that some of the students are not from art background. I think whatever that you have learned from here, you do not have to apply, you do not have to write research and talk about art. It can be applied in other areas because we all make history every day. There are some history that you find that what they have done but not recognized, and if you feel it's important, you can actually. Right, contextualize it, and then promote it, even though nobody is that interested. But it doesn't mean you have to limit yourself. I have a lot of books, and they are not art books. I'm not interested in art books, you know. So I come from a different way of looking at art. I appreciate art is the result or the symptom of society's changes, whatnot, reactions of society as well. So you don't have to feel like you regret or you are not able to use this knowledge because you've got the methodology, you've got the
suffering involved during this.
Yeah. I mean, because we push ourselves to, it must be about art. No, the methods that you have learned and the way of looking, you apply in the areas that you are interested in. It could be a personal history. You can blog about personal history of friend. It's actually very, very broad. It's very exciting. You are making history when you blog about something that is important to you but not known and you want to share, you are already contributing to the history, making our understanding of society richer. So if you can choose what you feel excited about and passionate about and you go into it knowing what you have gained. I don't have I'm an undergrad, I couldn't complete my master's. I'm sure what you're being here that you if you channel it into an area which you are interested in, you could use to your could be to your advantage. You can make a living side gig out of it.
Just one reaction to the narratives series. Not then when I was doing my master's, but it was more after. A lot of afterthought, a lot of subsequent discoveries from other books, but not. I mean, now that you put it forward to me, that. I use it as quite an intensive resource in my work. I was doing a research on the Mala. In fact, I was quite lucky because unfortunately I only met her once, but that once was about 4 hours. Eventually she passed away, I think, 3 to 4 months after I met her. And we were just, exchanging via WhatsApp to meet up again. And she kept procrastinating, she kept delaying, but eventually when I tried to get, then I just found out one day that she passed away. But there are two parts to what and how I want to address your question. The first one is regarding the book. I think it's a very good book in the way it's written, such that it focuses not in a biographical approach, definitely. It's more on certain works, certain a series done in response to certain policy, and it highlights, we try to position this work in relation to certain policy in the time or certain social political scenario. And so there's no right, there's no wrong. It's a very, very good book. If any teachers or lecturers here want to use the book as an educational material, I think it's a very good book. And if one is creative enough, you can actually try to approach your teaching process by gamifying it. And one day you tell the students, you try to pick a trap or a team out of this, just roll a view, say 1990s that come to mind, and then just tell the students, throw the book to them and say, tell me something about what happens in 1990s and pick a certain common trend that runs through 1990s. So you end up pouring through the book in search of the answer to that assignment. So I think in that respect it's a very good resource because the thing is that it's not done in a chronological manner, so I think it's good. It's good enough. It's quite rich. The other part is that I find after completing my master's, I'm not from arts background, I'm not an artist, but I love art. I used to draw and I don't draw that well, but fairly passable, average, but it's good enough. But one of the things that made me study and do this course here in UM is because I was just curious about what's the big deal about art selling millions of dollars out in the market. If you ask me, did I find an answer to that? I would say no, but I would say yes in a way, but it's not something that is commonly or widely believed, or at least people who want to widely believe and accept it. In the sense, I think that it's just all about money laundering. But I also find that the whole art world is very individualistic. It's like F1, if you win the race, all the glory goes to the driver, but not to the team, the supporting team. Those guys who actually change the tires, to do the time, time setting and all those things, you know. So artists, in a way, they're all very, it's very, very highly individualistic. You feel something, you want to write about it, you want to draw or paint about it, and like you said, I resonated with that very well. It's a product of its time. Different times, it comes in different artworks. Yeah. Response to, from within them, the feelings, emotion, and also to externally what's going on around them. Which is nothing wrong, there's nothing wrong with that, but at the end of the day, it's all about the artist and who or what I feel. And then, of course, there's a question about what makes you think, you know, your thoughts and your emotions is that worthy enough to be taken into account. I mean, there's nothing wrong, but I'm just saying it's very highly individualistic. That's why, in a way, after my master's, it sort of like drew me to want to explore other areas. I'm actually thinking of doing my PhD, but I'm not too sure yet, but more into permaculture, a little bit more in agriculture, because that's my interest in agriculture. And the special branch for agriculture is more on permaculture, and it's about observance of natural patterns. So you talk about art, it's all about artists, about a person, a human being. What if we can actually take art form and a land that we have as a canvas? And the artists themselves are the trees, the atmosphere that's surrounding around us. So it's just something very cursory, and I just had that thought recently. Yeah, so that's what I'm actually looking into, instead of just focusing on people, artists, you know. So yeah, coming back to the book, it's very helpful. The way it's written, there's no right or wrong, because if you ask me, can it be written or done any better, I can't say yet for sure. Perhaps a few years down the road, if I see something different or whatever, I can propose. But otherwise, for what it is right now, it's good enough. It really helped me to a certain extent.
Perhaps.
I think it's interesting you say that you can set an assignment from it. I really intend it as a starting point, and I hope that people will use the footnotes. Do more research. But it feels, I mean, for us looking back, our idea was to try to make it as broad and, I couldn't say balanced, but to see what we could put together, basically, from what information there was and who was researching at the time. So I mean, at the time, you were doing your research, just finished your research, Kelvin. And just really, so just pieced together like that, it's very organic. And I think the idea was to start more research and start hoping that people can finish art history and carry on and build on their stories. I mean, because certainly with artists, they're only like, just skim the surface. I mean, it doesn't really go into anyone's particular practice in great depth, except maybe I think that's Rahimuddin's piece on folklore, which talks about the Wanakula artist. But it skims the surface. So it's interesting you say you can use it and set it aside, because our hope is that people will use the footnotes and the bibliographies and want to expand and look at particular artist practices. I very much respect what you say about permaculture. It's something that, you know, even I think all of us, many of us probably come to this kind of feeling about the world right now. It's too me. But I think with art, the inspiring thing, I think the thing about the individualism is that it says that everyone has an individual voice. Everyone has an individual reaction. There is that everyone has the capacity to research and make something and spread and expand that knowledge. So without that, so to think of artists also as agents for maybe also helping us to understand where we come from or what's wrong or our issues or what's wrong, you know, and putting the next out there. So yes, artists, it's a very individual kind of practice, but they're sticking their necks out. It's very frightening, I think, being an artist, because that's what you do. You know, it's like burying your soul and always being judged. And they're taking the time and making your life's work, research, and expression. I think that's what's special about it. And that's nice response to. But I also completely understand what you mean by, yes, let's all sort of make a better world by being a bit more, bit less me. Yeah.
In a way, it helps because, I mean, like I said just now, it's not, there's no right or there's no wrong. I mean, about me, you know, in that aspect, because when they do so, they are actually producing materials as conversation starters, you know, like just now with regards to the question of why we learn art history. I think that's important because when we learn about art history, we know it's basically, I think, especially when you have a kid, I have a young 1.5-year-old boy. Kids can get very inquisitive. So art history itself can be a very good conversation starter. You know, you can tell them why this thing happened and in what context then and then, you know, it's a byproduct of the artist itself. And in a way it's good because when artists live through a certain experience, they produce a certain artwork. The artwork itself, in a way, it's been filtered down from the real event itself. So it's like, it's pre-digested in a different form. So you're actually learning about an event, but through the eyes of the artist, through a different perspective. So as a result, the works are richer. You know, if they want to say, talk about the recent elections at Pakatan Ubon, and then some artists do certain works, and then you can actually learn more about the event, about how the opposition then won through the artworks that they create in a different light, in a different lens. Yeah, so it's a very good thing. It's not that all bad. Yeah. So I believe artists are
I think that's what you mean by money laundering.
Yeah.
But it's at the same level. Artists don't do it. Not all artists go into it so that they can, you know, make the agency.
Yeah, but that's how the way...
It's not their fault. You know, it's not the fault of artists that we have that problem.
The artist is only a small little dot in the big ecosystem,
yeah.
And the success of an artist, he or she is doing well, it also benefits the other players in the ecosystem, the art workers, people like myself, the gallery owners, the publishers and so forth. But get back to the thing about individualism or individuality, it is something that we take for granted, especially art. Because the idea of an artist being a special someone is actually, it's a very recent idea, because artists in the past were craftsmen, they worked for the church, they worked for the rich, and were celebrating and promoting the ideals of their cultures. But the artist as a special person with a very special point of view about society or not, is actually surprisingly, I'm surprised, so, a very new idea. So that is why when you talk about art and craft, people say, oh, art is, art is about yourself, what makes you think that you're special, but craft is about culture, it's your identity. A few hundred years or a few thousand years of history to back you, is accepted as truth. And one of the examples I like to use is, you're feeling sad, Christmas is coming, you're feeling sad, right? But can you translate that sadness into your Christmas decorations? Instead of your Christmas tree being green, why don't you have a black Christmas tree? Instead of the stars being white, yellow, why not turn it red? Instead of gifts and all that, why not rubbish? You can't do that because that's not how we do it. We have always done this way. Why should it change because you feel sad? Then you can see the clear differences between what is craft and what is art. I'm not as an Asian, as a nation as well, we didn't go through all that kind of things that the rest have gone through, how they reject the culture and so forth and all that. We are quite lucky. We can still take the best of both and blend it or whatnot to our advantage, to our satisfaction. Some countries also, so some way of thinking, they reject culture because of what they have gone through in their civilization. So we have not gone through that. So we're quite lucky we're still able to play around with all this stuff.
Maybe we still have time left for, maybe I want to ask somebody from UIT and just give their response. Because I'm interested to know, since you come from art background, you are practicing artists, right?
Focus on the practicing part, so we are producing artworks constantly. So we are not focusing on the writing. So that's why maybe the product of I don't blame any decision, but from what I see, I think the artists that they came up from the art school is lacking on the part. So when they produce artwork, they cannot support it. There's a good writing. So maybe that's what happened when you call it individualistic, because the content is not strong enough to cover a big
audience. So for me, that's why I joined UM, for me to focus on my writing and at the same time I produce artwork, so that you can do both ways. For, I mean, I have a question, you know, what do you think about the young writers and practitioners that doing their own writings instead of asking for curator to curate their works? What do you think?
I think they all artists in Malaysia, all the artists were curators because they were
no curators.
All the curators are artists in here. All the curators are artists.
Yeah, I think you identify as an artist. I was trained as an artist, you know, but we had no choice. That's why we started writing and doing all this.
I identify as an artist because as long as I remember, it's kind of fun. Because they have been drawing and painting. So I don't just say that.
I think that maybe what you're asking is because there's kind of a system where you generally accept that somebody else writes about your work, represents your work. Mm-hmm. And you're talking about young artists representing themselves through their, presenting their work. I think it depends on the work you're doing and also what kind of context you're showing it. So it's like if it's your first solo exhibition and there's something. You know, it's in a very particular way. I think a lot of artists still, yes, curate their own shows, basically. It's, I think bringing in somebody else helps to grow that conversation. And obviously, we're becoming more of an ecosystem where there are curators, writers, more support systems. And it becomes a bigger conversation. It's just not the artists doing everything themselves. But it depends on the work, I think, really. And how also articulate the artist is and presenting their work. Different artists have different positions regarding people coming in.
I think the way I curate for previous shows, as bigger shows, if it's a solo, I usually would have Q&A for them. So they get, the artist will get to say what they want to say. But the way I write about the artist, it will be from my own point of view. So if you are as an artist, you are comfortable with different views, different perspectives on your work, that will enrich the reading into your work. If you actually want to write about it, that's even better. So you are the writer, and at the same time you might want to get another guest writer, someone you respect, who will read your work in another light. So we have like one of the things that really made me very pleased. One of the things that really made me very, very unhappy was when Malay had a retro experience back for Latin Beijing. And I remember, correct me if I'm wrong, there's only one writer. He's the curator and he's the writer. He's Kim Kusabu. And I felt that it was extremely, it was not broad-minded to allow many different, even conflicting readings of Latif. I mean, the question of why a series of work called Pago Pago was named, that was never answered. Why many things about Latif's development from looking at Nusantara and then going into different aspects, they're mostly Islamic ideas that we're talking about. He didn't want to share it. That's how I felt. He didn't want to share it. He didn't want the perspective from the younger generation looking at this from a mid-career. And from what I read, he was talking about he didn't want to process the input and ideas written about Latin by Sabadat, which I felt, you know, basically he was just, you know.
It was an attempt to counter. Perhaps it was an answer to the
problems
in some ways.
Yeah.
Because the last year.
Yeah, so it was very, very disappointing because the works were not, the works are all series, it's a retro, it's a very easy show to do. It has to be chronology. But we just need to know why, and we need to chart the development, how he arrived and what he has done today. But, you know, from one person's perspective, you're not going to provide a richer reading and also a critical reading into. I feel, you know, that was very, that's a good question. But some artists, they would rather write about their practices themselves. But if you don't mind, you know, other people reading your works differently, then it would also be good to get guests right there.
The artwork, in some way, it's also a piece of writing. Except that you have to know how to approach it, how to bring it upon, how to understand it. It's not easy. Sometimes even the artist cannot do that. Sometimes they need somebody else. Or that somebody else might not know what the art has, it should be by the artist. So that's a struggle which is wonderful. That's why I think we should not just talk about having art historians and artists. We should have journalists trained, well trained in art and cultural appreciation.
Sociologists, philosophers,
well, there should be reactions from all kinds of sectors in society when it comes to there's just not quite enough information. So, see, that particular lack that you mentioned, probably is what that instigates people to you know, see what they have written. Perhaps it should be written up. What have you said? Should have been written up.
I do think also that he maybe didn't want to repeat what had already been done at the Singapore Art Museum. I think there's a sense of kind of trying to do a different show from the kind of vast retrospective that's already been done. So as an odd, perhaps it's also strange that it's a second retrospective.
Yeah, but
I know what you mean, but
By the way, how do you select artists or works feature in your book?
We don't. It's all to do with the writers. It was more about, it grew very organically from an idea of wanting to kind of look at the different themes. It became thematic basically the whole series is built from conversation upon conversation among different editors that kept changing. And then also seeking other people's opinions about what would be interesting. And then also seeing what writing there is and seeing what people are researching and interested to write about. So all these things, it was no like proper sort of it wasn't a criteria, oh, we must cover XXX. But let's say we're definitely going to look at national cultural policy. Definitely looking at craft and Islamic art and modern art. Definitely looking. But then things would come up, gaps would appear. And then, oh, we need to fill this. Or who might want to write about this? So that's why it's, as I said, really much about what could be put together. I'm not saying that's everything that could be put together, but within our powers and reach. Together. So the works that are illustrated are whatever writers have elected to illustrate or talk about. So that's very interesting. This is how sort of canonization happens as well. I mean, which artworks are featured 10 times and are written about 10 times. And not that that's because of previous publications, national art, because they're in the National Art Gallery, the ones that come out in show after show, it does work in the sense that yes, this has become the powerful artwork. This is the one that's told us the most about, let's say, Abidin, or this is the work that talks about Malaysia Day, and it sticks in our imagination. Volume 2, we did pick out artworks that, for us, responded to specific points in our Malaysian history, like touch points. And yes, it was very obvious that an artist who has looked at the Kampung Baru in villages, Chong Kim Chu, or Yi Lan talking about Malaysia Day and how Malaysia came together. She did a special commemorative place. So artists specifically did that. So we chose those based on the events, artists who've done something about that event. Yeah. But other than that, it was really what the writers were talking about.
Just a question. You mentioned just now that there is a lack of writers, art writers. If you were to make changes or attempts, besides writing this book, what steps could be taken to increase an interest in art writing?
I think jobs. We need opportunities. There's no platforms, not enough platforms. Writing platforms are the most important thing. I think that we can look back at the 70s and 80s, and there was more opportunity for, in a way, the Asian press gave columns for art, for our writers, and there were journals where writers would contribute and exchange notes. And there's less, in a way, it's almost less of it today, because of the age of economics, I suppose. So platforms, that would be the main thing. I think we are actually running a kind of introductory writing, art writing workshop in Penang, and it's interesting how that there are quite a number of people interested in coming to it. But then where do they get to publish? So yes, they're curators, you've got obviously exhibition publications, but beyond that, where do you plan the meeting of different different writers and thoughts on art? We really need that platform again. Syntax was a very important journal, but that's unfortunately stopped operating for now. Yeah, so that's what we would do.
Today, social media, presence of social media, everybody can write.
But
it's there, and you don't even have to buy.
But there's sense of forum, because you're who reads it and who answers it.
True.
I mean, this is the problem. The how democratic is that format? And also, how does that become? How much of a document can that become if it's important research or things you want to archive?
I was wondering whether it would be nice to, the nicest one in the world, to write a fake art history.
Yes! Any idea?
Not history. But the other one is history of fake art. I mean, that's different, but it's fake art history. I mean, it's social media everything. You can have a whole audience of fake art history, championing certain auction houses and things like that. Read about it. Do I have to do a art? For auction? Mm-hmm. There's no thing about it. So
yeah, I think again it, you know, it's hard to make a living if as a writer, some money. And we have to acknowledge that because there is no interest. People are not interested in that because they see it as it's a distraction, it's expensive, it's a price, it's egotistical and all that. And even art writers themselves are not accepted for some of the works by artists. But if you are interested in going into this line, you have to be clear what you are, what are the areas you are interested in, and look for the artists that can support this idea that you have, that you are interested in. For example, like freedom or whatever, gender issues or whatever. You have this idea. There are artists who produce work who are on the same wavelength, and you can help to carry your, you can assist them, mutual assistance, to carry a certain agenda. Because everyone is only interested in doing anything if they are personally invested in it, and they're willing to do it without any remunerations. At least you have to do things for free sometimes, but it's worth it. You have to get out of the mindset where if I do this, I need to be paid. It's because you're not interested. But if you're interested in, for example, like gender studies, for example, you're interested in this area, and you like to promote the ideas from this area, again, seek out the artists who are on the same wavelength as you to basically help you carry this agenda, at the same time, to carry their works as well. So it's mutually beneficial.
What
do
you mean generally you want to support artists?
Yeah, but
you're passionate about that, then you. Yeah, but it's But I think, well, at the same time, we do need to cultivate, a value for the work of art writers. You know, so that, as I say, platforms, we need to cultivate that too. I don't know how that happens.
I don't know. The media doesn't seem to be interested because, like, the Straits Times have, they used to cover a lot of art. I mean, I grew up reading Straits Times and Star. That's where I got my exposure to local art. And they're not.
Star's not too bad.
The Sun, I was told by one of the writers that the editors are not interested.
Yeah.
You have to understand one thing. Anything that goes into media, especially printed media, you have to pay for it. It's a business. So arts, visual arts is one of the culture and arts is one of those areas, great areas where they basically, okay, I feel like featuring it because, you know, it's about art, it's about culture, it's a distraction. But if more important news comes, right, this will be, the editor will take it out. Like one of the senior art writers, he writes about art. But last minute, his story got pulled, his writing got pulled because they have other more important news to feature. So, you know, it's quite difficult.
Thank you very much to Mars. Thank you.